Good morning, everyone. Nice to see you all on this wonderful Saturday morning. Today is September 5th. So happy Teachers' Day to all of you. Because we believe that a teacher is not only in a classroom or an academic setting. Every human being has a teacher in each and every one of us. So on this important day, our heartfelt wishes to all of you, because we believe that you have a teacher in you for others to learn from. So taking us through this live today is Dr. Ali Khwaja, a teacher, a mentor, and a guide. So warm greetings from Team Bandera once again, and over to you, Dr. Ali.
Very good morning to all of you. And of course, a very, 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 very happy Teacher's Day. Let me tell you a little story. All good teachers tell stories, and that's what makes their classes interesting, right? Okay. Let me tell you a story about a young boy in Chennai who was not interested in studies. He came from a very poor family as it is. He couldn't go to one of these top-notch schools. So whatever nearby school his father could afford to send him, he sent him there. And this boy was just not interested in studies. He used to bunk classes, used to roam around all over town like the Tare Zameen Par kid, and used to be absolutely, you know, bindas. Then one fine day his father said that no, this way this guy will go astray. So at least whether he learns or not, let him have some discipline. So he went and got hold of some, you know, fathers, priests, and said, you know, can you please take this child? Because he knew that those priests are very strict and they maintain discipline and they won't allow this fellow to bunk and all that. So he said that, can you take over? They said yes. So he was shifted to that school. There, more than the discipline, the way those priests and the other teachers taught, this boy suddenly started taking an interest in studies. He started catching up and he started doing very well in his studies. So much so that by the time he finished his basic schooling, he actually got a scholarship, and all he had to do now was to choose the subject. His fees was taken care of, but books were not taken care of. And his father said, I can't afford to buy books for you. So this boy went running around and found that one relative of his had this huge heap of philosophy textbooks, right from the plus two to degree to MA to all that books he had. And he was willing to give it away to this boy. Ah, he picked up all those books and brought it, and he said, okay, so I'm going to study philosophy. 2 years he studied philosophy, did well. Then when he had to go in for his degree, again the same thing, he wanted to take up literature. But they said that since you have studied philosophy, we will give you a scholarship only if you continue to study in philosophy. What to do? Okay, so he studied philosophy. By the time he had finished his BA, he was a good student, he was performing well. They said if you study higher and if you do an MA and something. In fact, he had got a scholarship to go abroad, but he couldn't afford all those, you know, the basic costs and this and that. And he had to keep earning money to look after. He had a lot of siblings and his father was retiring around that time. So he said, okay, I will do an MA if I get a scholarship. He got a scholarship and he did his MA. And then he started looking for a job, a teaching job. He wanted to be a teacher. They found that there is no vacancy anywhere for a teacher of philosophy. Finally, he got a job as a lecturer of Malayalam. Now, this boy did not speak or write a word of Malayalam. When he got his appointment letter, he was shocked. He said, how do you expect me to teach Malayalam? The principal was a very wise man. He said, since there was a vacancy for a teacher in Malayalam, I have appointed you. You come to the college and teach philosophy, but you'll get your salary as teacher of Malayalam. That's how he started his career. Later on, he got a job in Mysore University, which had just been established. New university, doing very well, and patronage of the Maharaja of Mysore and all that. So he got a job over there. He started teaching philosophy. Amazingly, most of his seniors were Britishers. And when they were talking philosophy, they used to talk about the British or the Western philosophy, which obviously also connected to things like Christianity and the Western world's religions. This young man started talking about Indian philosophy and even questioning some of the Western philosophy. And he was in deep trouble. So he was wondering whether to quit from there and go back to Chennai or what to do and all that. And he got this opportunity in University of Calcutta. He was appointed there on a very handsome salary. He had started off on 35 rupees a month. University of Calcutta was offering him 500 rupees a month. Wow, he said, now I can take care of my entire family. And he took that up. It's very eventful that this young man, young boy, who hated studies, who used to bunk his own classes and this and that, that's how he started off, eventually became such a good teacher that when he was leaving Mysore, hundreds and thousands of students and parents gathered. They came to his house. The buggy that was to take him to the railway station, they removed the horses from that. And the students formed a long rope and they pulled his cart all the way from his house to the railway station. And on that particular day, the entire traffic in Mysore city came to a halt because of this procession. That is how much he was regarded and respected as a teacher. Of course, then he went off to Calcutta and there he did a lot of good things, etc., etc., etc. Have you been able to make a guess who I am talking about? It is Dr. S. Radhakrishnan. And today, why are we celebrating Teacher's Day? Ask children. Teacher's Day. Yes, a lot of children I know are very sentimental about their teacher. They will be making these handmade cards. They'll be greeting them. They'll be giving them some flowers and all that they're doing. But ask children, why September 5th? Why not any other day? Why is 5th September Teacher's Day? I can assure you, majority of the students don't know it. Okay, then go to their parents, the adults, ask them, why is 5th September Teacher's Day? And very proudly they will say, it is the birthday of Dr. Radhakrishnan, one of the greatest teachers of our country. Sorry to disappoint you, today is not Dr. Radhakrishnan's birthday. Dr. Radhakrishnan was born on 22nd September and not on 5th September. But when he shifted from that private school to the Christian school and they had not given any birth date, the priests over there decided that 22nd is a nice date. Oh, sorry, 5th is a nice date. And they had put down his birthday as 5th of September. And later on, Dr. Radhakrishnan kept protesting, saying that, no, this is the wrong date. I was born on 22nd and not on 5th. Nobody listened to him. So that's what became his official birthday. And that continued throughout his life, despite his protestations. How will we know all these things? We can know it if we take some interest in Dr. Radhakrishnan, right? Yes, eventually he went on to becoming the president of our great country. But I think that was only a very minor thing. In fact, he went on record to say, when I mentioned this Mysore incident to you, he said that I have been given great honors all over the world, literally, as President of India. He was given so many processions, so many awards, so many recognitions and all those type of things. He said, nothing is as important to me or nothing touched me as much as the way my students sent me, gave me a farewell when I was leaving Mysore. That is the heart of a true teacher. How many of us, frankly ask, have read the biography of Dr. Radhakrishnan to find out what he was, who was this type of person? When we say we are celebrating Teacher's Day, who was he, what was he, what is so important about him? What was his role as a teacher? All these type of things. In fact, Dr. Radhakrishnan, as any really good person and a very, you know, truly great person, refused to write his autobiography. He said, I'm not important enough for me to write my autobiography. His biography was written by his son, who is an eminent scholar in his own right, Dr. S. Gopal. So if you somehow, somewhere do get interested in this wonderful gentleman, read up the biography of Dr. S. Radhakrishnan, written by Dr. S. Gopal. And all these things which I have mentioned have been written by Dr. Gopal about his father. Now, one specific thing that I want to share with you about Dr. Radhakrishnan, when we talk about Teacher's Day and that we have a teacher in us and all that. Okay, he studied philosophy, he did very well, he was one of the toppers in his class, he became a teacher, professor, this, that, vice chancellor, all these posts that he held, all that is fine. But there was one thing about him, that when he got into philosophy, as I mentioned a minute back, he started questioning the Western philosophy. He started saying that the Indian philosophy has so much to offer and we are all Indians, teachers, students and all that. Why are we neglecting Indian philosophy and blindly copying the Western philosophy? And this was during the British reign. Even his own seniors, many of the authorities were all British. Can you imagine the type of resistance that he faced? Can you imagine how much they would have looked down? It is a fact. You read his biography, how much he suffered because of that. Otherwise, early in life, he would have gone to much higher positions. So the point is, he believed in something. Now, this is what I want should be the prime foundation of today's interaction. Do you teach what you believe in, or do you teach what is written in some textbook or what you have to teach? If you can answer that truthfully, and the answer is, I teach what I believe in. I'm not even talking about textbooks and curriculum and schools and colleges. You have a child at home and you want to teach him something. You want to teach him some values or principles. I don't use the word morals. You want to teach him something about good upbringing or good behavior or good interpersonal or life skills and things of that sort. Do you do it when you believe in something? Or do you just do it because that is what you are supposed to be talking about? Please truthfully ask yourself this question. You are a teacher, regardless of what other profession or vocation you are in. You have occasions to teach a lot of people a lot of things. A homemaker may teach her new domestic help how to keep the house clean. A parent, of course, teaches 100 things to the child. You have an elderly person in your house, a parent or a relative, who is not tech savvy at all and who says that I don't know how to send an email. If I knew, I would have written to my grandchild or something of that sort. So you teach that person that, okay, it's simple. I'll show you how it can be done. After that, you can start doing it independently. So you teach such people. Many, many, many a time, you teach by your own example. Remember that. Remember that children are very poor at listening to their adults, but they are very good at mimicking them. An excellent teacher is one who can be a role model, whose life itself should be enough for people to learn. One such great teacher, whom we lost a few years back, if you remember, is Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. And when I think of these stalwarts, I feel so proud that our country, our democratic country has elected such eminent people, be it Dr. S. Radhakrishnan, be it Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. We have appointed them to the highest position of our country as the president of the nation. People who were basically deep down humble teachers. And what made that difference? That's why I gave you the example of Dr. Radhakrishnan and his conflict with his Western peers with regard to philosophies. They believed in what they are teaching. So at every level, when you interact with somebody and when you expect that somebody to learn something from you, ask yourself, firstly, do I believe in what I am saying? Be a teacher to your own self. Teach yourself what is right and wrong, what is preferable, what is it that you believe in, what are the right values and principles and attitudes. Once you are convinced of that, I assure you, you don't even have to teach anybody. They learn automatically, as I said, by role modeling. People just look at you. People see your behavior and people start automatically learning from you. You become a lifelong teacher by your own life. This exactly happened with somebody like Mahatma Gandhi. He didn't go about preaching much. Even the speeches that he used to give are nothing compared to the huge oratory which today's politicians give. Today we put down our political opponents so miserably and badly. Mahatma Gandhi did not even put down the Britishers. He never said anything derogatory against any Britisher individually, or the British reign, or the British race. He only asked for what he felt should be given to us as a birthright, as something which we are not only demanding, but we deserve it. Added to him, of course, there were so many other wonderful teachers. Take Bal Gangadhar Tilak, who's known as Lokmanya Tilak. He said, Swaraj, that is self-rule, is my birthright. And I will have it. Full stop. Not that you British guys are horrible and you are cheats and you are corrupt and you are tyrants and I don't want you and this and that. Are you getting my point? Why I'm raising up these things? These are all long forgotten. Nobody even talks about people like Gandhi and Tilak, and nobody even, I think, now even talks about Abdul Kalam. We have already forgotten him in the first few years. But why I'm raising this up is to tell you that do we believe in what we are doing? We automatically become role models, and role models are the best teachers at any given time. On the other hand, you must be seeing that there are a lot of small children. When they get together, two, three, four of them, and they want to play a game, they come out with this idea saying that, okay, we will play the game called school, right? And suddenly one of them will jump up and say, I will be teacher, I will be teacher. Now, looking at that child, you may be very impressed saying that, this little one wants to become a teacher. He or she wants to teach the friends and the other children who are playing with him. No. You know what he does? He goes and picks up the foot rule, this, you know, plastic or the wooden thing which you use to measure the scale. And he says, if you don't keep quiet, if you don't sit properly, I will hit you. So what's the bottom line? I want to be a teacher because I can hold the scale and the foot rule and I can hit you legally. That is the image of teachers among children. What do we achieve by being such teachers? Daddy is very strict. He will not allow me to go out and play till I do my homework. mummy forces me to sit and study. Ah, daddy has become a teacher, mummy has become a teacher. But is that the way children learn? Is that the way we are supposed to be teaching them? Whether we like it or not, if we are parents, we have to be teachers. We have to supplement the teacher when the child comes back home to check what he has learned, whether he has taken down the notes, whether he's doing his homework, whether he's preparing for the test, all that make us an assistant teacher, whether we like it or not. The question that I am asking is that, do we do it firstly as role models? And secondly, do we do it because we believe that this is the right thing for the child to learn? If you can answer that question truthfully to yourself. But I find around me a lot of people who have forgotten what the whole idea of teaching is supposed to be. Teaching is supposed to be learning, right? There's a wonderful proverb that says, if you cannot teach the way a child learns, then teach the way that the child can learn. Come out with a way by which the child can learn. You can't say that I'm teaching something whether the child learns or not is his responsibility. And if he doesn't learn, I'm going to punish him. I'm going to put him in detention. I'm going to make him write 100 times. I'm going to fail him in the test and things like that. Is that teachers? Let me tell you a very, very interesting story. I do hope that you are still interested in listening to stories. You are, no? Hopefully. Okay. Don't ask me whether this story is true. I've told this to many of our students. Please excuse me, those who have heard this story, but I just can't resist repeating it today because it is Teacher's Day. There was this wonderful school teacher in a small village, passionate about teaching the children in the village. He wanted to do nothing else. He would not only prepare his lessons well, take care of the children, understand them, make the classes as interesting as possible, he would do all that. After school hours also, he used to take interest in those children who are lagging behind. And he used to give them free tuitions. If they don't come, he would walk down to their house and sit down with them and teach them. And he had this fantastic record that in 35 years of his teaching career, no child had ever failed in his class. The moment he identifies a child as falling behind, he would put in so much efforts with the child that by the end of the year, the child would pick up and would pass. Now it has come to the last academic year. At the end of this year, this teacher is going to retire with this wonderful record, right? No. In the last year, he got a child. One student was totally incorrigible. He did not learn. He did not want to learn. He was not capable of learning. He had no interest in learning. So our teacher took him under his wings. This is a challenge for me. Every day he would make efforts to somehow see to it that this child also picks up. He went on and on and on throughout the year without success. The year had come to an end, the final annual exam, and he knew that this boy is going to fail and his 35-year-old record is going to go down just before retirement. He was miserable. He got a bright idea. He went to the principal and said, "Sir, 35 years of service, have I ever asked for a personal favor?" Principal said, "No." "Have I ever, you know, been found wanting in my performance?" "No, you have been a perfect and a wonderful teacher." "So, sir, just a few days before my retirement, can I ask you for a personal favor?" Principal said, "If it is within my control, just ask and I'll give it to you. I have so much regard for you, sir." So this boy who is going to fail, give me permission to set an easier question paper to him. All other students will get a separate question paper. This boy will get a separate question paper, which will be so easy that he will be able to answer and we can pass him. Principal was shocked. He said, "This is totally unethical. We have never done something like this. But who is this person asking? My most committed and most dedicated and most efficient teacher who's going to retire in a few days." Principal said, "Okay, I will allow you. So you know what this person did? He thought of the easiest possible question. Question number one. How many legs does a cow have? He's asking that to a village child. Even if the child still has a doubt, he can just look out of the window, see a cow grazing, count the number of legs and write down the answer. But you know what our man did, the student? He wrote 3. And the answer paper came to the principal, and the principal was fuming mad. He called this teacher and said, "See, you made me break my principles. You made me do something unethical. And now see what this stupid fellow has written. You still want to pass him?" He thought over the teacher, said, "Sir, will you listen to me for a minute?" "Yes, what is it?" "Sir, you tell me, sir, how many legs does a cow have?" "What a stupid question, yeah. 4 legs, obviously." "Okay, sir. Sir, what has this boy written?" "He has written 3. "Yes, sir. Can we give him 75% of the marks, sir? 3 out of 4 he has written correct." This, however unethical it may sound to you, is the true spirit of a teacher. Can I teach this child the fact that he has already learned that there are at least 3 legs to a cow? Can I teach him the 4th leg and make him better? Or do I say, stupid, good for nothing fellow, you write a wrong answer, I'm going to take a red pen and put a big cross and a 0 and throw you out of the class and detain you or fail you or something of that sort. Now, this is an attitude which we have to take whenever we are teaching, and I'm not restricting this to school and college teaching. You are in a responsible position in an office. Inevitably, you have to teach some of your junior colleagues. You may be in a very, very ordinary position in an office. You're not a manager. You're not a great guy. You're just working at the very entry and basic level. But a new candidate comes and joins. You've already been there for so many years, so you've got used to whatever work is being done. This boy has come newly. He doesn't know some very basic things about how to go about doing. So you become a teacher, right? The boss calls you and says, teach him, you know, whatever are the things to be done so that he can do the work properly and stuff like that. Fine. Then what do you do? Number one, do you bring out that inner teacher in you and say, I have been given an opportunity to help somebody learn. When he grows, I grow along with him. If he can perform, it is a feather in my cap, whether he acknowledges it or not. And when I'm teaching him something, do I teach him what I believe in, what I feel is right, what I feel is the best option under these circumstances? Do I take interest in the person? Do I see how much he is learning? My guru of management, Sharu Rangnekar, he is cross 90 and still going fine. I wish him a long life. Sharu Rangnekar said, if you want to teach Ramu mathematics, it is not enough to know mathematics. And he stopped. And we were all staring at him. What is he trying to say? You want to teach Ramu mathematics? It is not enough to know mathematics. You should know biology, is it? Then, after a long, poignant silence, he said, you should also know Ramu. That is the crux of teaching. Be it your own child whom you are trying to inculcate some good habits in him. Be it a colleague in office whom you are trying to improve efficiency. Be it a student whom you are formally teaching. Be it an elder who has become a little outdated and you want to help him. Whenever you are trying to teach, are you teaching after understanding what the person knows, what the person wants, what is the method by which he will learn, and then and only proceed with the teaching? How this goes on and how do we do all these things from our side, whatever we have been doing, Very briefly, I will request our director Purnima to just quickly update you, and then I will be really looking forward to a lots of questions from you. Please feel free, not only questions, I love comments. I love, you know, opinions which are different from mine. That's how a debate happens, and that's how we all learn. So just listen to what Purnima has to say and be ready with your comments and your questions.
Thank you, Ali, and a very warm welcome and a happy Teacher's Day to each one of you for having been that teacher from whom I'm sure so many lives you would have touched, and you would have also ensured that, you know, people learn something from you. Warm greetings again from Team Banjara to you. I think nowadays, as we say, that no talk or no activity is complete without mention of COVID. So I will also get that little COVID into my talk. The COVID times have been a little too, you know, tumultuous and trying for students, because they have had their own, you know, share of anxiety, their own share of worries, not knowing when the exams begin, when they end, and what happens. And along with that, we have actually, it's so heartening to know that along with the students, there are so many teachers who have actually been so concerned about their students, because they have seen them, you know, right from maybe class KG and 1 and 2 till 10th and 12th. And, you know, now they want to just move out and they want to carve out a future for themselves. However, because of these medical emergencies which have been felt not only in India but all over the world, there have been, you know, some little disturbances in their thought processes. And to help them facilitate, what we do at Banjara is we offer what is called as a free career counseling. So that is one facility which we do. And in fact, I must tell you that there have been so many teachers who have actually called us up and, you know, asked us that if we can address parents, if we can address teachers, if we can address students and help them out with, you know, helping those children in doing their career selection. It's very important, right? They have a choice of plenty. And at the same time, there is so much of confusion also. And whatever the, you know, thoughts they have, I want to become a doctor, I want to become an F1 racer, I want to become a journalist. It's so very appropriate in these circumstances that they are in. So what we have done is that on Tuesday, 8th September, we have kept, you know, we are conducting, Dr. Ali will be doing a class, a special session, which is on career guidance and selection process. This, we have kept it open more so for all those people who want to, you know, help the younger generation in deciding their careers. So what you could possibly do is, you will need to call up office. You will need to speak to our program coordinator, Seema. And we have very, very limited seats available. This is also, you know, our appreciation and gratitude to the whole teacher community, because there are many teachers who are actually wanting to be counselors. So for teachers who want to be counselors and who also want to guide their own students into the different career paths that are available, Dr. Ali will be giving a talk on 8th September. It is from 11 to 12:30. So in case you have all the three requirements set in, being a teacher, wanting to be a counselor, and also wanting to guide children into good career paths, please call up office and let us know your interest in wanting to join. That with that, I will now hand over the talk to Dr. Ali, who is ready to know your thoughts, agree to disagree, ask questions, and say, hey, no, I don't think I agree to that. Oh, yes, I think I do agree to that. Tell it all, and we'll be more than happy to have the chat continued with you.
Right. So as I await questions from you, let me quickly recount that human beings went from the caveman's era to the village or the agricultural setup. Then we went on to the industrial setup. And then we went on into the IT era, which is also referred to rightly as ICT, Information and Communication Technology. As you know, information has exploded. They say that the amount of information that was generated in 2000 years, that much information is being generated maybe in 2000 hours nowadays. So that is the way information is expanding. So when we want to teach as a teacher, formally or informally, we do not have to provide information. Information is available at the touch of a button. There's this wonderful teacher available to all the students 24/7 into 365 days. She doesn't take summer breaks. She doesn't take weekends. She doesn't go to sleep in the night. You know who I'm talking about. Google Auntie. Google Auntie is there. Wonderful teacher. Any information that you want, she is willing to give at the touch of a button. So whenever we talk about teaching or about learning, please let us remember that giving information is not the purpose of teaching. There is a new acronym which has been coined called DRIP, D-R-I-P. It is a short form for data rich, DR, data rich, IP, insight poor. Data we have got endless. The insights to understand from that data or apply that data is poor. That is what learning needs to be done now. And as Rumno rightly said, why is there so much gap between ideal and actual teaching? Why don't we see committed teachers? That's a philosophical question, Rumno. Perhaps if Dr. Radhakrishnan was alive, he would have been able to answer. All I can say is we cannot just blame the uncommitted teachers. It's a vicious cycle. The whole system has to change, which is not that easy. But we can change the one or two or 10 or 100 people around us who are willing to listen to us. We can do so much with those people. If you are teaching, be a committed teacher. If you know a teacher who doesn't seem to be committed, find out why she is not committed. What are her issues? So many times it happens when I'm doing some orientation or something for teachers, and while the management, parents, everybody has complained, saying that these teachers are not committed, they are not sincere, they are not teaching properly. When I sit down to talk to the teachers, so much comes out about their woes, their limitations, their roadblocks, their challenges, which are not being met by anybody, and they are just being questioned, why are you not committed? It doesn't work that way. We have to create a system. For example, I'm told that there are some Scandinavian countries, Finland, for example, I am told that teachers in Finland are given better salaries and higher respect than the top administrators, let's say the equivalent of IAS officers. In Finland, a teacher gets more salary and respect than the equivalent of an IAS officer. That is what we need to do. Maybe we can't afford to pay them that way, but we can definitely afford to give them that type of respect. Are we doing that? So that is what I want you to understand. Bharti has been a teacher for 35 years, which has been extremely satisfying. As you quoted, I kept knowing Ramus and Sitas. I have found that parents' attitude towards the teachers influence the attitude of their children. Obviously, a parent is 10 times greater teacher and more influential teacher than the best of teachers. Because a child is with a teacher for a few hours in a day, and that too 5 or 5.5 days in the week, and that too minusing all the Dasara vacations and the, you know, summer vacations and the long COVID vacation and all that. Finally, whom is the child left with the parents? And while parents do not necessarily have to open textbooks and teach from there, parents build up the attitude of the child, and that is extremely important. Please understand, if you are a parent or if you are any adult who has influence over a child, it may be your younger sibling, it may be a nephew or niece, it could be anybody. If you are an adult who has an influence over children, please be very careful what sort of a role model you are and what you are doing with those children. Navina says, Hitchki was a wonderful movie which showed how a wonderful teacher can touch and change students' lives. How beautifully she made the subject so interesting and made the students excel. Yes, and there are teachers like this all around you. Every now and then I come across a teacher like this, and I am absolutely fascinated to see what that teacher can do and has been doing. In fact, today also happens to be the birthday of my teacher and guide in IIT Bombay. He was just a few years older than me. He was still completing his PhD when he started teaching, and I was the first batch whom he guided. And I don't know how great a teacher he was, because I never studied the subject that he taught me, and I never pursued the engineering that he was supposed to have taught me. I never learned that, and I never pursued it. But I always held him in high regard for the way he taught me certain values of life. That time BTech was 5 years, and it was compulsory for us to stay in the hostel. So day in and day out, morning, evening, sometime late at night, we used to keep interacting with our teacher in the labs and canteens and all that. And I have learned so much from such teachers. I could go on reeling. I'm sure all of you also have such teachers. Rina says it's very important to model, manage, and leave memories for our children to walk the talk and learn from our mistakes as teachers do. That is a wonderful thing, Rina. I'm glad you brought that out. Do we acknowledge our mistakes in front of the younger generation? Please ask yourself that. We all make mistakes. We do the wrong thing. Do we acknowledge and say, yes, I was wrong. Yes, I should not have shouted at you. Yes, what I said earlier, I changed my mind and I'm not right at it. A good teacher is one who is always open to learning, unlearning, and relearning. Yes, Varnika says, people tend to say school days are the best days, mostly because of the way they were treated by some wonderful teachers. And at the same time, let me tell you that school days can be very horrible if the teachers are not good, however knowledgeable they are. If the teachers have not built that rapport and that friendship with the children, if they have not won their respect, you have to command respect. You cannot demand respect. Another quick short story. There was one school in a village, and all the children were walking towards the school early in the morning, and they suddenly saw that the whole school building has caught fire. Such a huge fire that the entire building was gutted down to ashes. Now, if you are still a child at heart, and if you know students, please tell me, what do you think the children did when they saw that the entire school has burned down to ashes? All the children jumped up in joy. Yay, school has burned down. Only one boy, a wise young fellow, was standing in the corner and sulking. And they said, what's wrong with you here? We are all celebrating that the school has burned down, and you are sitting with one frown on your face. This boy said, yes, school has burned down, but teachers are outside. Now that is what happens if the teachers don't connect. They are not good role models. Teachers can make the life of a child. Teachers can destroy the life of a child. Yes, Shirin is asking, can we have a system like the IAS, etc., to recruit the best in the country? You'll be amazed, Shirin, that we did have such a system right from the British days. Dr. S. Radhakrishnan was a member of the Madras Provincial Education Service, and he aspired to become a member of the Indian Education Service, which was denied to him for a long time for various reasons. You will read it in his biography. So there was an Indian Education Service existing from the British days. But you know, our bureaucrat said, what are these teachers? Tomorrow you give them one label like IES or something of that sort. Tomorrow they'll start competing with us. They'll start sitting next to us and demanding lal batti cars or flags and something of that sort. So abolish it. And they got rid of it. This is why, to the earlier question, why is it that teachers are not committed? Bhavna says, thanks for bringing up the attitude of our teacher even while interacting with juniors and colleagues. This makes a great difference in the way I would communicate. Vidya very rightly says, it's important to have a humanitarian spirit to be a good teacher. Yes, without that, however knowledgeable you are, whatever your number of degrees and whatever may be your years of experience, you really cannot be a good teacher. Nagratna says, I'm forever grateful to all the teachers of my children in guiding and molding them in the right way. That is the attitude. Do we express gratitude to the teachers of our children? It is my child. I am going to reap the benefits of the child when he grows up and becomes a good citizen. The teacher will move on. The teacher will retire. The teacher will be teaching other people. So are we sending off the teacher with a word of gratitude, an expression of our thanks? Anu says, thank you for your wonderful insights on the teacher in all of us. Happy Teacher's Day, and let the light in you shine brighter and reflect on others. Archana says, if we look around, teachers are there everywhere, whether younger to us or older than us, and each day we can learn something new. Thanks for pointing that out, Archana, because I am very, very convinced that we can learn much more from the younger generation than what we teach them. Because when data is not important, information and knowledge is not important, insights are important, attitudes are important, freshness, creative thinking is important. And that is where the younger generation can be great teachers. If we are willing to be students to them, they can teach us so much about life. Shobna says, teacher is a humble and noble profession. Please do not shame this attitude. No, definitely not. There's no question of shaming the attitude. I have the highest regard and respect for teachers of every possible kind. All I am pointing out to is where we can improve, where we can introspect, where we can think, can I do something better? I'm in a very responsible position. If I'm teaching anybody, whether I'm teaching my juniors in the office, whether I'm teaching my family members and youngsters, whether I'm a professional teacher, it's a great responsibility. As Sonia rightly says, teacher who treats them well and teaches well, kids see them as God. My son tells a teacher, God. Yes, that is the level to which a teacher can rise in the eyes of the student. And this is again regardless of the age. Even as adults, we learn from somebody. If you allow me to be immodest, since morning I've been getting such touching, such wonderful messages from my students, and my students are all adults. Some of them are even elder than me. But the type of gratitude, the type of expression that they make about what they have learned by going through this diploma in counseling skills or whatever they have learned in Banjara, it is so rewarding, I can't tell you. It is far, far more rewarding than any other profession, any other activity which I could have ever done in my life. Yes, Vidya rightly says, we'll never get bored when we are interested in learning. And when a child says he or she is bored, then there's something really wrong with the development of the child. And there is something wrong in the way we are teaching. Here again, I'm not putting down the teachers. I'm telling you, think. Why is it that when I'm such a committed and such an efficient teacher, my child is getting bored? It's my responsibility to see that that boredom is lifted, and I can do it. if I am innovative, if I go down to the level of the child and help him to understand. Our children, Reena says, can be the best teachers for us to walk closely with them and learn from. That's exactly what I was saying a minute back. There is so much that we can learn from the younger generation, not only our own children. Look around anywhere. Look for people who are just a few years younger than you, or maybe decades younger than you. Everywhere there is something or the other to learn from the children, provided we have that attitude. That is what is important to us. The primary thing, you know, which a teacher does, or at least should do, is, in a single word, empowerment. Am I empowering the students, the learners, the people whom I am interacting with them? Am I making them autonomous? Am I teaching them to run their own life? I still remember a story which one Swamiji who runs an ashram had told me long back. So somebody had deposited a newborn baby who was completely crippled. He couldn't move his hands and legs, he couldn't talk, he couldn't even feed himself. The ashram took him in and started taking care of him and started bringing him up. They were giving him whatever it is, he was lying in one corner, till one philanthropist turned up one day and said, why is this child lying in the corner and not doing anything? They said, sir, this is the problem. He can't walk, he can't get up, he can't do this. That man went and spoke to the best of doctors, came back and said, I will bear the expenses of whatever the surgery and the sent therapy that this child needs. Let's make him capable. And that child was gone through a lot of surgeries, therapies, physiotherapy, this, that, everything. And in a few years, that child got up, could stand, walk, run. And he is as normal a child as anybody else. The Swamiji tells this story and says, today that child is 35 years old. Please tell me, what do you think the child must be doing now? And you know, the disciples would turn around and say, maybe he has become a teacher, maybe he himself has become a Swami, maybe he has become a doctor so that he can help other people. So they come out with all these answers. The Swamiji tells wistfully, no. He is right now languishing in a 6 feet by 8 feet jail in central prison. Huh? You know what happened? We gave him a lot of love and attention because he was crippled. We pampered him no end. And then came all this treatment and all that, and he got up and he started walking. But by the time, he had become so emotionally dependent that he didn't want to do anything by himself. And he wanted to look for shortcuts. He started going and begging from people. Then he started cheating people. Then he started taking unwanted money from people. One fine day, he got himself into a lot of trouble and he committed a murder. And today he is lying in jail on a life sentence. He doesn't need to walk because he's locked up in a tiny cell. So the moral of the story that Swamiji told us was, when you teach a child how to walk, teach him the direction in which he has to walk. That is absolutely critical. Yes, Vavna, the word empowerment is more kind and powerful. Indra says, the present generation have not got the kind of environment at home and in school which we have enjoyed. It's definitely our responsibility to first put sense into parents and to think. Yes, I agree. And each one of us can do whatever little bit we can do. That is what we need to look at. Navina has been very kind in acknowledging whatever little I have been able to do to her and to so many other students who have written back to me. Even a simple thing like books. Why do I write small, small books costing 20 rupees, 16 pages, 24 pages, that sort of thing? Because the idea is, let me reach out in different ways to people. They have this little book which they can buy for 10 or 20 rupees, keep it with them. Maybe someday they feel they want to learn a little more about this particular topic, and then they start reading that up. And they learn so many other things. We are getting a lot of, you know, Happy Teachers Day messages from all of you. I acknowledge all of you individually and collectively. Paroma rightly says we all need teachers all the time. Yes, that's another very important thing. And when I say teachers, I'm not even restricting it to human beings. This stray dog which comes into our office every day, whom we call Dottie, she teaches us a lot of things. Nature teaches us so much. That is one thing which I always say. Never deprive a growing child or a youngster from learning from nature. Nature is one of the best teachers. The moment all this lockdown business is lifted, please make up for it by taking the children out into nature. You don't have to plan thousands of miles or go to foreign countries and all that. Take them 100 miles away from your place, into nature, into open spaces, into villages, into hills, and see how much they learn from just that experience of being out with nature. Satyavati is remembering Raja, my mentor. Yes, Raja was the strong pillar of Banjara. He passed away in 2011, but he has left an indelible mark. All those who learned counseling and so many other things from him will, I'm sure, will never forget it. And more than that, they will cherish what they have learned from them. Yes, Varnika says, from Dottie, I learned to excuse and not to bite back our loved ones when they stamp us. Isn't that also learning? These are all the various things day to day we all keep, learning and things of that sort. One last point I want to make before, I hand over to Seema for doing a quick and very interesting, wind up. Number one, two things I wanted to tell. One is, please inculcate the habit of reading. It could be some nice article, not the news part of it, but some nice articles which come even in your daily newspaper. I hope you still know what is a newspaper. It could be small magazines. It could be small booklets. It could be, take a book and read 2 pages per day for the next 100 days to complete the book. But do include the habit of reading into you. Books, articles can teach us so much, and at your own pace, at your own convenience. That is one way, and inculcate that habit into the youngsters of today, who, as you know, are losing the habit of reading. The second and last point is attitude. If you have a positive attitude, it rubs off. And if you inculcate a positive attitude in your learners, be it your child, be it your student, be it your grandfather, if you inculcate a positive attitude. So let me end up with telling you one last story. Once upon a time, there was this huge company called Bata Shoes. Every city, every town used to have a Bata shoe shop. And that used to be the number one. People who wanted good shoes or good slippers would go only to Bata. One fine day, the management of Bata said, we have spread all over the country, in every state, every town, every city. But we have not gone to Andaman Islands on one side and Lakshadweep Islands on the other side. So why not consider the option of opening shops? They sent 2 salesmen, one to Andaman and one to Lakshadweep. Survey the market and tell us whether it is worth starting a shop over there. The fellow who went to Andaman said, I went there. The entire island is full of tribals. They don't wear any footwear. They walk barefoot all over the jungle. There is no scope to sell footwear over here. Not only we don't need to open a shop, I'm packing up and cutting short my visit and coming back tomorrow. The salesman who was sent to the Lakshadweep Islands sent a telegram saying, I was amazed when I came here that not a single person wears footwear. All of them are our potential customers. They don't have shoes and slippers. Opening the shop will be later, but first send a consignment of shoes and slippers. I'll start selling them from tomorrow. What was the difference? Attitude. Develop a positive attitude and you will see how the entire world changes. And that is something which I would like Seema to wind up and tell you in a minute, and then we will end this program. Over to you, Seema.
Hi. Ali, thank you again for that wonderful session. Every Saturday we get you one or the other topics, and again, see you tomorrow. See you again next Saturday. Now, before that, as a teacher, I feel there are two things that can be done. One, of course, the students want to reach out to you emotionally, and the second is that students want to know what next, especially as they are nearing 10th standard, 11th standard. Now, Banjara here has career guidance and counseling. Career counseling is absolutely free at the academy. And for that, what we are doing this Tuesday on 8th of September, we have a classroom session on career guidance by Dr. Ali. This is for our DCA students. But if any of you is interested, just call up our office and fix up an appointment. We have very, very limited seats because of social distancing. But this is a classroom session which is going to be conducted by Ali. He'll give us many tips on how to correct, wisely choose your career. So that is one. And again, as a teacher, how do you emotionally reach out to your students and as an adult to your children and other children who are in your life? How do you do that? One is, of course, you're always emotionally there for them. But if you want to know a very systematic and scientific way of doing that, and like many teachers already enrolled for our DCS program, if you want to learn in a very systematic way, how can you counsel students in your school or at home or anywhere else, you can find out from us about our Diploma in Counseling Skills course, which is a very popular course. And two of our batches have already gotten started in August. And on 15th and 16th of September, we are starting the other two teams also. This is a one-year part-time program. So the next admission will only happen next year. So in case you're interested in finding out, please contact our office and speak to us. We'll be more than glad to tell you. So this is how we can influence in whatever way and make our the life of our children better in days to come. So see you again next Saturday. We'll go live again, same place, same time. Thank you so much.